he had an image, positive as well as negative. So positive was utilized for the election purpose, and negative will be utilized by the Pakistan Army and ISI and the clerics to keep him under check, to keep him under control. The calendar of protests is issued by Huriyat, and it is for the local leaders, for the local clerics, for the local people. If they do not follow the diktat, then there is a kind of social ostracization in November 16 when the demonetization took place, and after that there was a cash crunch with the militants and their finances from across, because all these currency notes went out of circulation. It had no value, and that is when the ATM looting started. ATM looting started to overcome the cash crunch. In the long term, we need to have these servers here. We need to have our own versions of WhatsApp, Facebook, and that is the time. And look what China has done. China has done exactly the same thing. They, for them to imagine that their family will get lakhs of rupees is a reason enough for them to pick up a gun, get trained and come across. This entire system is well coordinated by the ISI. The Pakistan Army definitely colluded. So what starts as a recruitment from Pakistan and then subsequently through a process they are pushed across, this is how it always happens. And this is along with the weapons, along with the warlike stores, along with currency, so that they are able to come and manage to survive in society here. Now let me also tell you that every Kashmiri household is not a supporter. Sensibility shows that they have to be well behind in depth. Whether they are 40, whether they are 20, whether they are 80 is not the issue. What is more important to understand is that there has to be an international pressure. There has to be a kind of pressure which has to be brought up on Pakistan government to stop this business of having terrorist camps. And yes, there was a particular lapse and the military did take action against it. As far as the intelligence part is concerned, specific intelligence no one will be ever able to give. Intelligence played a major role. A lot of credit goes to the battalion commanders, to the brigade commanders, to the divisional commanders, who got tactical intelligence, because these were tactical operations, and these tactical operations needed specific intelligence on ground, and this was facilitated by the troops on ground, who knew exactly each place, each position. They knew the habits of the Pakistani elements who were there, and they knew exactly what time, on what particular day, period of day or night, where these people would be. So tactical intelligence was absolutely superb. Pakistan Army and ISI have a record that the moment some talks start taking place, then there is a major attack, whether it happens on the Parliament House or whether it happens even in Jammu and Kashmir State Assembly, but it happens. And if the nation, which is looking at ending this kind of a turbulence which has been going on for decades, I think it is finally the act of the political leaders, whether they are at local level or at national level. And there, empowerment of the local leaders and their acceptance in civil society there is the key, so that they can take the masses along and bring in a consciousness and a kind of a stand for the Huriyat or the people, the masters across, for them to understand that the people are not supporting it anymore. It is the local political leaders who have the key to success.
Hello and welcome. My name is Shailesh Kumar and you are watching National Defense. What is the end game in Kashmir? How does Pakistan play its terror tactics? Would relations between India and Pakistan ever change after Imran Khan taking over as Prime Minister of Pakistan? None can better tell than Lieutenant General VG Khandare, who headed India's top defense intelligence agency DIA during the surgical strikes across LOC in Pakistan Occupied Kashmir. General Khandare superannuated just a few weeks back.
Imran Khan's emergence on the political scene in Pakistan should not come as too much of a surprise to people who have been watching Pakistan intently. It was very clear that Nawaz Sharif had run into foul weather with Pakistan Army and ISI. Actually, in Pakistan, you can always see historically, they have had the controls in the hand of Pakistan Army, ISI and clerics also. So, when you look at Nawaz Sharif emerging on the scene, and he ran into trouble with a number of chiefs of army staff, despite the fact that it appeared that he was selecting his own candidate, but he always ran into trouble with a number of chiefs, and Parvez Musharraf was one of them. But Pakistan Army did not lose control over the national situation in Pakistan, and with the help of ISI, they ensured that either Nawaz Sharif was kept out of the country, or if he came in here, with the help of their judiciary and a controlled media, they painted him as a corrupt politician. That is their internal matter. We do not want to get involved into whether he was corrupt or whether he was clean. But at the same time, they wanted to ensure that a politician who does not have too much of experience should emerge at the national level, and then he has to look at the current establishment, which has power, but it does not appear so, at least very clearly, and that is this troika of Pakistan Army, ISI and clerics. And Imran Khan suited to be the best possible candidate in this. He had an image, positive as well as negative. So positive was utilized for the election purpose, and negative will be utilized by the Pakistan Army and ISI and the clerics to keep him under check, to keep him under control, and have whatever is decided by these three elements.
It is not just Pakistan Army whose existence depends on India and particularly Kashmir, but Pakistan's political leadership also survives on anti-India campaigns.
In Pakistan, there are different segments of society with different colors of public opinion. Amongst them, the lot of people who say that there should be peace with India is a minority. And the large segment of them would be possibly fence sitters, and there is another small element which wants to always have confrontation with India. And confrontation with India suits the existence of Pakistan Army. Pakistan Army continues to be the most powerful establishment in Pakistan. I cannot call it a true democracy in that form. And if Pakistan Army suggests even for a moment that there is peace on its eastern front with India, then the existence of Pakistan Army will start getting questioned. The relevance of that establishment and the huge budget that they enjoy and the kind of privileges their senior generals enjoy in society while in service as well as after retirement, all that will start getting questioned. On similar lines, when you look at their clerics, they also enjoy a position of power, because one factor which they always bring up to unite the people and the public opinion in Pakistan is an anti-India stance. At whatever stage, you can see since 1947, whenever there has been some kind of an internal turmoil or turbulence, dissatisfaction of the masses, they have always brought up the anti-India issue. And then starting from the person who's on the street, right up to the chief of army staff or even the head of the state, they all combine, and that brings a lot of unity in the people of Pakistan, that is the anti-India establishment. So I think for the existence of Pakistan and for the position of supremacy of Pakistan Army in their society, the position of their clerics, they have to have this hate campaign against India, and Imran Khan in that position suits best. Imran Khan has been speaking against India, and that is what most of the politicians do. Any politician in Pakistan, if he speaks of peace with India, that is the end of his political career. And Imran Khan has understood this very well, and he will continue to do this as long as he has to depend on the mercy of the Pakistan Army, which is going to be for a substantial period of time.
Kashmiris demand Azadi, but what does this Azadi mean? General Khandare, who himself has served in Kashmir, explains the real meaning of Azadi and how the word itself twisted by a bunch of Pakistani supporters.
The position in Kashmir as of today, the kind of turbulence which is taking place, to a large extent it has reduced after the coordinated actions which have been taken on the political front, on the military front. There's a lot of synergy which is working, and Jammu and Kashmir policemen being targeted, their families being targeted, is most unfortunate, because the J&K police is one of the finest police force that we have seen. Granted to them that they have experienced these kind of situations for the last so many years, they have honed their skill, they have become good, whether it is in policing or whether it is in counter-terrorism as well. Their police officers are the most experienced officers, and they carry out a lot of combined and synergetic operations with the Indian armed forces as well as the other security forces who are positioned there. What is the relevance and what is the position of Pakistan in a Kashmiri's mind vis-a-vis India? There are some people who say that they want Azadi. There are some people who just say Azadi for the sake of it. They may really not understand what Azadi as a term implies, but that term of Azadi is synonymous with protest. When you talk to them separately, they say, no, we do not want Azadi, but this is a slogan which invites a lot of attention in Delhi, a lot of attention within Kashmir, so we use the word Azadi. So that is something for the rest of the country to understand, that Azadi is something synonymous and a catchword for people to collect. Now, when people collect, do they get collected based on motivation, or do they get collected based on peer pressure? To a large extent, majority of them are there based on peer pressure. When you talk of stone pelters assemble there based on a call given by somebody. Who is that somebody? That somebody is the person who has to obey the diktat which is being given to him, that there should be a protest at so and so place. The calendar of protests is issued by Huriyat, and it is for the local leaders, for the local clerics, for the local people. If they do not follow the diktat, then there is a kind of social ostracization that particular region would suffer at the hands of those people who matter in Kashmir in civil society. That civil society, when we want to further dissect that, most of it is in the hands of Huriyat. So if Huriyat says there will be a protest, then there is no choice for the local people to obey that diktat. Even if it causes them a kind of inconvenience, they will have to do it. And not so surprisingly for people like us, when the local people go through a lot of suffering or deprivation because of continuous bans, continuous agitation, a large number of them do discreetly approach the security forces, and their requirements are met. But it is never publicized, because we also value the existence of this civil society, who are good people, who are balanced people, but are doing this agitation based on compulsion. So what exactly is the militant lobby wanting to do by pressurizing J&K police, by targeting their families, is something which our civil society also needs to look at. Is this not human right violation of the Jammu Kashmir police people? There has to be a debate on this. There has to be a recognition of the fact that so much of a challenge for a J&K police, whether he is an SP or whether he is the highest level DG police, there is a tremendous amount of pressure which is working on them, and it is for the civil society in Jammu and Kashmir which has to condemn these activities by the militants.
After November 2006, all of a sudden, terrorists started robbing ATMs. Why was that cash crunch? General Khandare explains as how drug trafficking could be next modus operandi of terror groups struggling for cash.
I have an experience right from the time when this agitation and the agitational dynamics and stone pelting became a big issue somewhere in 2010, when I was myself there. And I saw very deeply, and subsequently also at high levels I witnessed, how this whole thing is orchestrated. They are sold a kind of a dream, they are sold a kind of a vision that this is possibly the only way that civil society can contribute, and by sheer numbers. And those numbers are those who come onto the streets and prevent the security forces from carrying out legitimate military operations or legitimate security operations. Now, when you use human shields, you are actually, I'm talking of the Hurriyat or the militants who call for such activities, you are playing with the lives of innocent children, you are playing with the lives of these women who come onto the streets. And hiding behind that and then escaping is not the best form of chivalry or gallant action that these militants want to portray there. How do these people get collected? So a call is given and it is expected that all the residents of that particular village or town should come out on the streets, and there is somebody who is watching them and they say, okay, why did your children not come up, or why did your children not come onto the street? And then the society or the people who are calling these actions, they start boycotting them. In any village, you can understand how a family would feel if they start getting boycotted in their own community. So it is a kind of a compulsion. That is one factor. The other part which you have to look at is the funding. Pakistan definitely was very much involved in sending counterfeit currency, which was being printed across. And that money used to find its way into the hands of these distributors. These distributors used to dish out this money to the youth. The youth, especially those who may not have had the best education, those who may not have jobs, they turn out in huge numbers onto the streets. They are now financed by these people in a manner which is not visible to others but is known to everyone. And this is one factor which was understood by the government, and when demonetization was brought in, this was addressed to a large extent. Now you please correlate how in November 16, when the demonetization took place, and after that there was a cash crunch with the militants and their financiers from across, because all these currency notes went out of circulation. It had no value. And that is when the ATM looting started. ATM looting started to overcome the cash crunch, and snatching of weapons from ATM guards and policemen started, because the security forces to a large extent had controlled infiltration and the smuggling of weapons. So when weapons were now required and cash was required, so that is the time they brought in the tactics of looting ATMs, using that cash for survival, for progressing their operations, and using these snatched weapons to be used against the security forces. So that is how they perform. And I personally feel that they will find ways and means of overcoming this cash crunch, maybe by use of drug smuggling, because this is a low volume content but with a high value. So if after some time they start printing counterfeit currency again, so they may overcome this cash crunch. But to a large extent, this got controlled with the proactive measures taken by the Indian government.
A very few would actually know on ground how ISI and Pakistan Army push armed terrorists inside India. General Khandare tells first-hand stories of poor Pakistani citizen radicalized by clerics and lured by Pakistan Army to create havoc in India.
In terms of infiltration, there is a counter infiltration grid which is in place, which is quite robust. And in the earlier days, there was no fence. So the groups which used to infiltrate, obviously with the help of some local guides who would have worked for money, these groups were huge. They were to a tune of 50 people coming in a group, or even more than that. And then subsequently, this fence which came up, the anti-infiltration obstacle system as it is known, so the number of people in a group reduced. And it was a process of evolution, that the fence came, then the militants developed techniques of crossing the fence without getting noticed. There were certain patches which are still there, where nature is quite cruel in that particular area. There are flash floods and the entire fence gets washed away. There are certain rocky patches. There are snowbound areas where the kind of snowfall, the residual snow, even piles up much higher than the level of the fence. And as you know, in that area, after a particular time, when there is a lot of wind which blows, the snow becomes ice and it is easy for a person to walk across. So these are the challenges faced by the Indian security forces, which are manning the obstacle system, and they are continuously vigilant despite heavy snowfall, despite periods of absolute darkness. There are certain patches which are illuminated, there are certain patches which cannot be illuminated, and there are certain patches which have to be guarded round the clock, there are certain patches which have to be visited very often. And with these challenges, the security agencies kept working well and the number of infiltrators kept reducing. The availability of terrorists across is dictated by the kind of poverty and the kind of radicalism that is spread in the youth there. There are enough number of people who can be motivated on the other side, and they necessarily are not Kashmiris. They are from Punjab, they are from Karachi. I have seen myself a poor boy who was picked up by these clerics, not motivated, actually pressurized to come across. And when he was caught alive, and he had all stories which he gave us, and we knew that out of sheer compulsion, where there are large families, these young boys are told that, okay, you go across and your family will be compensated. You spend this much of time, if you are still alive, we will pull you back. If you are not alive, then you are going to Jannat, and your family will be compensated hugely. For them to imagine that their family will get lakhs of rupees is a reason enough for them to pick up a gun, get trained and come across. This entire system is well coordinated by the ISI. The Pakistan Army definitely colludes in this. There are certain areas where the local guides know that these are difficult patches but can be used for infiltration. And those are the things which help in infiltration. Infiltration gets minimized, but all over the world, you can see in any particular place, it will be practically impossible to assume that between two countries there is a hermetically sealed border. It cannot be made to exist. And there will be certain periods during the year where weather and nature will play a role superior to the existing means that are created by us. Along with those obstacle systems, there is a lot of technology used, and there is a lot of motivation of the security forces which minimizes this infiltration. So we must grant the security forces that they are doing a very good job, but 100% prevention of infiltration may be possibly utopia.
General Khandare finally dissects Pakistan Army's launchpad across LOC and financing of guides hired to infiltrate weaponized terrorists inside India. But how do some of these terrorists survive? Listen in to what former DGDIA General Khandare says.
How ISI plans it well is to pick up these poor boys and take them to terrorist training camps. So these training camps are well into the interior of Pakistan, and these are run in a manner that terrorists are trained for 1 month or 3 months, and they are given the basic military training. And once they are given this basic military training, then they are allowed to move around in society, meet their parents, and then again called back when they get their plan ready how to infiltrate a group. Now, when they have to infiltrate a group, they plan it well. They plan it as to which is the gap through which they want to try their luck, and for which there has to be a launch pad well forward. And that launch pad is generally in the area of one of the battalions of Pakistan Army, which is along the line of control. So very clearly, now you see that ISI picks up people through the recruiters. The recruiters are a mixed group of clerics as well as the ISI people. They identify people in society from poor families. They take them, they radicalize them, they brainwash them. They take them to terrorist training camps, give them a period of training, identify from amongst them those who have a better knack for specific jobs like possibly preparing the IEDs or the explosive devices, or for cyber, for such specific jobs they identify talent. They segregate them, then they train them further. But those who are to be their foot soldiers are the ones thereafter, once they have been trained, they have been radicalized enough, they have been spoken to by people like Hafiz Saeed or Maulana Masood Azhar. Thereafter they go, say a final goodbye to their families, or at times they are not even allowed to do that, and they are moved forward to those launch pads. Now, let us understand, launch pad is no structure as such. A launch pad is a very flexible arrangement of getting terrorists together, giving them weapons and warlike stores, giving them logistic stores, keeping them there, getting a local guide and pushing them through. Now, the moment you do surgical strikes, those launch pads vanish for a period of time. Then they can re-emerge. They will re-emerge. In this entire case of how they are pushed across, the payments which are made to these guides who are from POK or could be even from our side, they are given huge sums of money, and that money or that financing comes from ISI. Once they are pushed across into India, quite a few of them get killed in that process of infiltration. Maybe a couple of them may manage to sneak in. Then there is another local resident who is one of the black sheep in the civil society, who is supposed to receive them and then take them and make them merge into civil population, or take them into certain hides in places where they have local sympathizers or overground workers. And then they are again ready to take up action against the Indian security forces or the Indian democratic system. So what starts as a recruitment from Pakistan and then subsequently through a process they are pushed across, this is how it always happens. And this is along with the weapons, along with the warlike stores, along with currency, so that they are able to come and manage to survive in society here. Now, let me also tell you that every Kashmiri household is not a supporter, at least not willfully. Maybe by a kind of pressure, compulsion, that they may do it. But please also see, the number of terrorists have reduced, and the number of these leaders from amongst these terrorist groups have been targeted, which means there is definitely intelligence available with the security forces, where they pick up a particular target and eliminate the leadership. If you are able to eliminate the leadership, then the momentum which the terrorists want to gain is always restricted, controlled, and even in a manner degraded. So in the last couple of days, last couple of months, we have witnessed the security forces targeting a large number of leaders. That's a very good strategy.
In recent years, Pakistani terrorists started targeting military bases. Why? General Khandare tells the time when peace can be restored at LOC. Let's listen in.
A selection of targets by the terrorists or by the ISI, which plans these issues, selections of military bases is one of the options which they have utilized in the last couple of years. Prior to this, please see, there were times when they were targeting places like Red Fort or Parliament House or religious places. Even prior to that, if you see, in the area of Rajouri districts, they were targeting the Hindu population, wedding procession of a Hindu family which got targeted. And this was a continuous process in which they understood that they need to keep changing these targets, because if they continue to target only one particular type, then they do not succeed. And the methodology of targeting each of these was different, like targeting a wedding procession of a community was to create a kind of a scare so that these people would move away from there and there would be mass migration, and then there will be a demographic total conversion in that area, and that entire area would form a part of a plan in which the arc of terrorism could keep spreading southwards from Kashmir towards Jammu. So that was the initial plan. Then subsequently they realized that the armed forces, the security forces, were spread out in a manner and they were dominating a large area. Now they needed to make sure that this playground of theirs, more space would be available to them. And to give them more space, they started attacking the bases so that the security forces would spend more time, resources and energy in guarding their own bases so that they are not shown in poor light in front of the international audience or the national audience, or even have their own confidence go down. We have seen how they were quite, they had targeted Kaluchak. I am talking of the past. So it is nothing new. So basically, it is a kind of a tactics that if they target our bases, then the security forces will have to spend and contribute more effort towards securing these bases rather than getting into counter infiltration grid, which also shows that while we need to protect our bases much better, with the optimum level of manpower and with the optimum level of technology, for at no stage should we reduce the efficacy and the efficiency of our counter infiltration grid. Because if we succumb to this kind of a pressure, then you will have an increased infiltration, you will have more attempts, you will have more number of people coming in. The bat actions which you spoke of, again, these are something which have been happening for a very long period. They do it, there is retaliation, we never claim. So surgical strikes was one thing where it was announced to them that look, we have done it. Post the surgical strike, the DGMO went public and said, we've done it. We say that it was a retaliation for what you did to us, and we are stopping these operations, please don't write again. Small pinpricks on both sides will keep happening. This is reality on the line of control. Those in uniform understand it very well. As long as this line of control issue continues, the moral ascendancy on line of control will continue to have ceasefire violations, it will continue to have bat actions and retaliations. So this is something which is not new, and I do not see it stopping unless there is a proactive stance from the Pakistan side that we are going to have peace on line of control. That is their call, and as per whatever conditions which they specify, there can be a dialogue on that. But bat action or targeting of bases, I think, is something which will continue. We have to be careful, but we should not reduce our effort on the counter infiltration grid.
General Khandare accepts there were military lapses during Uri attack in which 17 of Indian Army personnels got killed. Was this an intelligence failure?
Along the line of control, there is a perpetual threat 24 hours round the year. It can never be said that there will be a particular period of peace. Uri was a very peculiar case, very unfortunate, so many lives were lost. That was the time when a new battalion was coming and relieving a battalion which had completed its tenure and it was to go back. And that was the weak link which was identified by them. To my mind, definitely there would have been some local elements who would have passed the information across that this is a likely target. And yes, there was a particular lapse and the military did take action against it. As far as the intelligence part is concerned, specific intelligence no one will be ever able to give that today at this time there is going to be a raid in this particular area or a bat action in this area. A generic kind of information is always available, and what has to be ensured is the alertness, the commitment of the people who are there manning those areas. And after Uri, a lot of lessons were learned, and the highest possible leadership as well as the local leadership, they brought in a lot of good changes, and they were not only restricted to intelligence, they were also spread out in terms of the procedures to be followed, the practices to be adopted, how to improve on our method of functioning so that we do not provide another such instance to the enemy. So I think it may not have been only with reference to intelligence, but a lot many things, and they have been addressed.
India avenged Uri attack by launching precision surgical strikes across LOC in POK. General Khandare, first time tells you how intelligence was gathered to carry out these surgical strikes.
Surgical strikes definitely were a big success, and the nation for the first time was told that this is how our state, our nation state would respond to those people who bring in violence into our country, and especially along the line of control. We have been doing such actions across the line of control, but at the local level. This was the first time that at such a mass scale, such a massive scale, with the high leadership very much giving a sanction and also announcing it to the world that we have done it. It was at a scale simultaneously which was covering a vast geographical expanse, and it was done with precision. We did not suffer casualties in that particular action, and there were large number of casualties inflicted across. Intelligence played a major role. A lot of credit goes to the battalion commanders, to the brigade commanders, to the divisional commanders, who got tactical intelligence, because these were tactical operations, and these tactical operations needed specific intelligence on ground, and this was facilitated by the troops on ground, who knew exactly each place, each position. They knew the habits of the Pakistani elements who were there, and they knew exactly what time on what particular day, period of day or night, where these people would be. So tactical intelligence was absolutely superb. A lot of work went into that, a lot of risk was taken into that, and for those people who want to know a lot of details, I would just like to reassure them that many a time when we give out our exact modus operandi, it closes our future options. We should not subject our future generations or those currently who are operating there to a handicap if they have to do the same thing again. Specifics need not be discussed in public domain, except that there has to be an assurance to the Indian public that the very best action possible is taken by people who are planning these operations, preparing for these operations, and operationalize the plans in a manner that it gives a lot of success to the nation. I think it would be very unfortunate if we give out these details in public domain and for subsequent plans we suffer greatly because the adversary would have already learnt how we did it. We have done it as young officers, we have done it as COs, and we were very fortunate that these techniques, methods, the practices which we followed were never made public, and that was one of the reasons that we succeeded so well during the surgical strikes. Video shows what was the action. The video does not show how it was prepared. The video does not give out the details of how exactly each action was taken. It does show the effect. I think the effect was also conveyed to the public because there was a lot of argument which was there in public domain, and I think it was a decision of the government to do it in whichever manner, or if it was, I am not too sure as to how it was made public, whether it was made by the government's action or it was made by somebody else. But all the same, that was for the mass consumption of the people and those who had started to feel that as being alleged by some elements in our society that nothing happened, they were shown that, okay, look, this is what has happened. But what went behind that and what went into the preparations and how exactly the conduct was definitely is not a part of that video.
When we know who are the enemies of India perpetrating terror in Kashmir and rest part of India, then why don't we eliminate the enemies of the nation freely living in Pakistan? General Khandare says strategies sometimes override our capabilities.
This issue, let's look at this. If we have very clearly identified who are the people who are radicalizing the youth on the other side, the ones who are motivating them to pick up weapons against India, we also know who are financing them. Are we to target individuals or are we to target a system which exists across? If you target one of the prominent leaders, what is the assurance that there won't be another prominent leader who will come up? So we have to now have a strategy in place to say that while leadership targeting is very good, it is a part of the overall plan. But what should be the overall effect? The effect should be that this system which finances, which supports terrorism, which creates terrorism and a proxy war into India, that entire system needs to change in our neighborhood. Do we have our capability to do it, or can we do it alone, or is there a lot of international pressure that is required to be exerted on our neighbors so that this business of radicalization and a kind of a democracy which is subjugated by their army for their own personal gains. So I think what needs is a systemic change there rather than targeting specific individuals. Individuals compromised, eliminated, will again resurface with some other names. So it is an endless game. But if we have to have long-term stable relations, the system there needs to undergo a change, and we need to have a stable neighbor. Otherwise, the kind of turmoil and turbulence which gets created in their society gets exported to our place, and here they are able to identify those people who collude with them. So the first issue is to look inwards also and see who are the people who are colluding with them, and to take action against them, to bring in a system that nobody colludes with them, or those who collude can be immediately picked up and that can be prevented. At the same time, use our diplomacy, our kind of political and economic power, to ensure that the people across, they understand. And I think that's exactly what the Indian government has all through trying to do to strengthen the democracy across. But unfortunately, right from 1947, Pakistan Army and ISI have a record that the moment some talks start taking place, then there is a major attack, whether it happens on the Parliament House or whether it happens even in Jammu and Kashmir State Assembly, but it happens. So the need is to change the system across, and only then can we expect. I think a few eliminations here and there may not really matter, but yes, that is an option which a state always keeps with itself.
Terror and stone pelting is fanned by social media, particularly in Kashmir. Should India ban internet, or how to leverage social media in tackling terror and stone pelting? Listen in what General says.
Social media, since the time it has come to a common man, there are a lot of challenges which have been thrown up by those people who make use for evil designs. Now, you are aware ISIS, the way it used social media, radicalized people all over the world, publicized their achievements. In fact, they ensured that the mainstream media as well as social media both contributed to their successes. Those mainstream media journalists who or correspondents who had been kidnapped by them, that particular news of ISIS was on the front headlines. And when this gentleman was released, he said that, look, they were rejoicing that continuously my news was on the front page. So the understanding which the terrorists have achieved of how to use mainstream media as well as the social media is tremendous. Now, what are the responses that we can look at? Do we have a technological capability to ask WhatsApp and to have Facebook help us in this? Please look at these technologies which have been provided to us from the West. The control of this social media is not in India. It is somewhere else. There is a lot of talk that has to be done with the people who handle this. Each of these, they are private entrepreneurs. They have their own company policies. Whether they agree to you or they don't agree to you is their decision. As a nation, what should be our response? Long term and short term. Short term is what effectively we are doing is, at that particular point in time, in that area, the internet is switched off. It is declared also, and it is switched off. But mass switching of internet does not take place as a rule or as a habit, because the collateral damage or the collateral influence on common people should not be felt. So the security forces and the state is very cautious that a local action should not cause trouble to the masses who are in other areas. This is what we are doing in the short term. In the long term, what do we do? In the long term, we need to have these servers here. We need to have our own versions of WhatsApp, Facebook, and that is the time. And look what China has done. China has done exactly the same thing. they have their own platform, they have their own tools. And that is the time when they decide, the state decides what is national security and up to what level would privacy and freedom be allowed. I think a legitimately and popularly elected government is well entitled to take a decision as to what is the limit for national security and where it is getting compromised based on freedom or privacy. There has to be a call which is taken by such a government which is popularly elected. Long term, this is the way. Short term, I think what is being done on ground is fair enough. There is a lot of success that has also been achieved, and it is a cat and mouse game. We achieve something, then they go a notch higher, then we again go higher. So it is always going there. What is most important to understand is the discomfort for common people is kept in mind, and this kind of action is kept to the bare minimum as per the operational requirement.
So what is the end game in Kashmir? What General Khandare says is the real answer to Kashmir problem. But is the government listening him? Hope so.
There's a lot of synergy in the intelligence and operation and the various security agencies which are there. The upgrading of capability of each of these agencies which is operating there and synergy has seen a vast improvement from what it started with. There is a lot of joint training which is taking place. There is training of the CRPF people by the military. So all that is going in the right direction. But finally, this is not a solution which is to be given by the military. This is a solution which has to come up from civil society. This is a solution which has to come up from the democratic institutions. And the stakeholders are there in Kashmir as well as in Delhi as well as all over India. I think if we need to look at this issue, currently what is happening is conflict management, for which the security agencies are well capable and they are doing it. But when you look at conflict resolution, that is much beyond the purview of the security agencies. And if the nation, which is looking at ending this kind of a turbulence which has been going on for decades, I think it is finally the act of the political leaders, whether they are at local level or at national level. And there, empowerment of the local leaders and their acceptance in civil society there is the key, so that they can take the masses along and bring in a consciousness and a kind of a stand for the Hurriyat or the people, the masters across, for them to understand that the people are not supporting it anymore. It is the local political leaders who have the key to success.
Thank you for watching this exclusive interview of Lieutenant General VG Khandare with me. If you like the interview, give a thumbs up. If you want more of such interviews in future, do write your feedback in the comment box. I will be thankful if you share the video, and don't forget to subscribe National Defense Channel to get notified of future videos. Keep watching National Defense. Jai Hind.